Hi to all our fellow Heritage residents. I'm Rick Morton, and with me is Ecker, and if you don't know him, you will in a second. Most of you probably do. We're going to talk to X in just a minute, but what we're doing today is trying to give you an idea of how easy it is to play bocce. If you're watching this video, it's probably because you're interested in the game. You may be new here. People come from all over the country, and a lot of people, many people, have never seen bocce, certainly never played bocce, and we want everyone to know how easy it is to participate in this really, really fun game. That's what we're doing here, okay? X Ecker, if you don't know, is the president of our HHG, which is the Heritage Homeowners Group, which is a...
advocacy group for the neighborhood.
Thank you. I never know how to say that. We have a... it gives us a way to talk to the board of our actual Heritage HOA. Mm-hmm. So he is the president of that, but more important, he is our guru when it comes to everything bocce. Right?
Sure, Rick.
Yeah. He and his lovely wife, Diane, they run the leagues. They keep all the scores. They keep all the accounts. They know everything that's going on. He's responsible for the most part for the courts and getting them in shape. Yeah. Right? How did you become so darn interested in bocce?
Well, actually, growing up, it was a neighborhood game. Lots of people played it. Lots of bars and taverns as I got older played it as well. So it was just an interesting, fun game to play without any prep, any certain athletic attire or anything. You just play it anywhere.
Yeah. Do you know the history of bocce?
I do. In fact, it's probably the oldest game in civilization played with a ball.
5200 BC.
That's old.
I read it. there was a picture on a wall in an Egypt tomb of a young boy with a ball. Now, I mean, it could have been a pumpkin, right?
But right.
They assumed that it was bocce. But.
Right. And most people know it from Italian-American immigrants, and it came to this country via that. And probably every Italian-American club in the United States has a bocce league or team, and many taverns in Italian neighborhoods.
Yeah. And, you know, I also read that it wasn't all that spread out across the country until 1989, when there was a bocce boom in California. As California goes, the rest of the country goes. And it took off, and pretty soon you could buy low-cost bocce kits in Walmart, and it's just spread, and now it's a very, very popular game.
It is.
Yeah. Okay, so basically, what's the point of the game? What are we trying to accomplish when we play?
In the simplest terms, try to get your bocce ball, the large green or red ball, closest to the Pallino, the white ball that looks like a cue ball.
The little white one.
Right.
So someone throws that first?
The first thing you do is have a coin toss to start the game. And then once that is determined, the team that wins the coin toss takes the Pallino and a bocce ball. The other team that didn't win the coin toss gets to choose the color of ball they would like, and off they go. The team that has the Pallino throws it past the center line and then throws their bocce ball as close as they can to it.
Okay. What happens if they hit it?
That's good.
It's okay?
Yeah, great.
All right.
Closer, better.
Shall we try this?
Yes.
Okay. You're going to toss the coin?
I'm going to toss the coin.
All right.
I failed to mention that in each of our club bag of balls, we have all 8 bocce balls, the correct Pallino, a coin for coin toss, and a set of rules, which everyone should read. Heritage bocce rules, because there are hundreds of kinds of rules on the internet. This is our set of rules.
Okay. Good.
So
I'll take those.
We have the coin. Here it is. There's heads and there's tails. We'll flip it. It's heads.
Who goes?
Carlo called heads. He's over there. He's going to throw first.
Okay.
Okay. Carlo's throwing the Pallino. And he throws the Pallino past the white center line. And it looks like a good throw, sort of in four part of the court. Past the center line. So now he's going to throw his bocce ball, his green ball, as close as he can to the Pallino. And when you throw first, like Carlo has done, it really doesn't matter how close you are. That distance sets the point. Now red, Dale must throw to get inside of that green ball, closer to the Pallino. Looks like Dale's stepping up to the red foul line. Dale's doing what is called pointing, where you don't move when you throw. He lofts one in there, and the red ball comes down towards the Pelino. Red, okay, so it looks like the red's closer. Carlos steps up to the red foul line. He throws the green Bocce ball towards the Pelino. This one's closing in, almost hits it and stops, and as you can see, is closer than the red ball. So red must throw to get closer. Dale steps up to the red foul line, and the red ball comes down towards the Pelino, and it hits the green ball, and...
So what would happen if he had hit the Pelino when it's already been placed?
Once again, still doesn't matter as long as it's a valid shot. In other words, it can hit the Pelino, you can hit the sideboard and hit the Pelino. You can hit the Pelino and drive it into the sideboard. The only thing you can't do to make a dead shot is to throw the ball all the way down to the end and hit the bumper without hitting another ball or the Pelino.
And then it comes out?
It comes out of the court. It is a dead ball. Okay. Carlos steps up to the red foul line. He throws the green Bocce ball towards the Pelino. This one's closing in, almost hits it and stops. And as you can see, is closer than the red ball. So red must throw to get closer. Dale steps up to the red foul line, lofts one. It's gone past the center line towards the Pelino. And, oh, went past the green ball. So red still has to throw because the point is to the green. You have to get your ball, your Bocce ball, closer to the Pelino than the other team. So Dale's thrown his red ball, going past the center line, right towards the Pelino, and it's closer. So the point is now red, green must throw. Carlo steps up behind the foul line. He tosses it towards the Pelino. And, oh, just past the red. So red still has the point, and there's still one green ball to throw. So Carlo has a chance to get closer. Green ball's tracking towards the Pelino. And it stops just a beam. And I think probably the green is closer. So
it looks like now they're pretty close.
So what's going to happen here is Karen's going to place the cup over the Pelino and hold it down tight. Diane's going to take the measuring tape, which doesn't matter whether it's inches or centimeters, it's just units. She measures it and gets a number. She comes over to the red ball, and it looks like the green ball is closer. Captain can call for a measurement at any time, so one person on each team, and a referee can call for a measurement anytime he or she desires. So in our Bocce League kits, bags, there's a measuring device like this, which will be used to measure over the Pelino and towards the Bocce ball. There's measuring devices like this that you'll see online, which just looks like an antenna, so you can measure to the ball. And we even had one of our former referees, Alan Zabo, who's now not with us, use a laser measuring device to see how far away the Pelino is from the Bocce ball. You can even go onto the App Store, Apple or Google, and get an app measuring device. I've found those lacking compared to any of the manual ones.
So he's got one ball left.
Right.
One red ball.
Right.
This is it. If he doesn't get closer,
then it's Green's point.
Green's point. Okay.
Okay, the red ball's tracking in. It's getting closer and closer. And when it comes to a stop, it is closer than the green ball. So in this case, one red point. So Judy in the purple shirt, which is on Dale's team, she now gets to throw the Pelino and a red ball to establish the point.
And we just basically start over again and do exactly the same thing.
Right. We have 1 point scored for red, and we could have 1 to 4 points scored on either team this frame.
It's like bowling. You've got frames, right?
Right. Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to go first with the Pelino.
Yes.
And the Pelino
must go past the center line. And for heritage rules, if you do not throw it past the center line, it goes to a white dot painted on the court. That speeds up play.
Right.
In other rules, you'll get to throw it a couple times, or the other team could throw it and still make you throw the bocce. So
put
a way
it in
to
the
speed,
and let it go.
Right, speed up play, put it on the white dot and let it go. Because red won the frame, we go down, the balls will all go to the other end of the court. The other members of the team will throw. And in this case, because red won, red will throw the Pollino again and the bocce to establish the point. Judy's going to throw the Pollino now. She steps up to the red foul line. Again, you can step on it, but not over it. She's got it past the center line. So it is a valid throw of the Pollino. Now she's going to take the red ball, which she has in hand, and she's going to throw it as close as she can to the Pollino. She throws it. Looks like it might hit the sideboard. Again, still a valid throw. Probably 12 or 15 feet from the Pollino, but that establishes the point. So now green just has to get closer than red. So Lisa steps up to the foul line. She lets the green ball go. The green ball does not have to get past the center line. It just has to get closest to the Pollino. So in this case, that's exactly what she's done. The green is closer to the Pollino than the red. And so now red must throw to get closer than green already is. Judy steps up to the foul line, lets it go. It's tracking a little speedy, and past the Pollino it goes, and still further away than green. So green still has the point. Judy steps up to the foul line, stops just outside the green ball. So now the green ball is still closer, and Judy throws again. This one's tracking in nicely. It's gonna come to a stop, much closer. So now red is in. So Lisa's going to have to try to throw a green ball closer than that red ball. Lisa steps up to the foul line. It's tracking in towards the Pollino, starting to slow down. It hits the Pollino. However, when it hits the Pollino, it looks like it's tracked it closer to the red ball, and now red is still in. So now she's going to throw again in an effort to try to either knock that out or get closer. Oh, awesome shot. So now, not only is the green ball closer to the Pollino, her other green ball may actually be closer to the Pollino, and that would score 2 points. So right now there's 2 points scored.
Yes.
And if she can get one closer to the Pollino than the red ball, it'll be 3 points. It's coming. It looks a little weak. Ah, it's a little short. But still, 2 green points. Nicely done. Her last ball wasn't any closer than the red ball, so only 2 points total scored. But very, very well thrown a frame.
Okay, and now we just go back to the other side and do it all again.
We do. We go back to the other side, and because green won that frame, green will get to throw the Pollino and the first bocce.
Okay, I want to talk to you just briefly about the court itself, the dimensions of the court.
We have tournament-sized courts, and so by regulation, I won't go into all the millimeters because they are really in a metric system, but they're about 91 feet long and a little over 13 feet wide. And so that's, you'll see a 60 by 10, you'll see some smaller indoor courts, maybe 40 by 8 or so, but really a 91 by 13 foot court is a regulation United States Bocce Federation court.
And we play on putting green artificial turf.
Right, this is high quality synthetic grass.
Yeah.
And there's a little layer underneath it of concrete. It should be a nice big true rectangle.
Right, well, looks like a rectangle to me.
It is. Considering some people play on dirt.
And crushed oyster shells.
Crushed oysters.
That was the Italian way of doing
right.
it.
Right, well, for all the people that didn't get to be here. For all the people in Heritage that didn't get to be here 3 years ago or more, we actually had, Lennar had put down before this turf, crushed oyster shell, which took off in a windstorm.
Right. I believe
it was a tornado of shells.
That doesn't make a lot of sense. Okay, let's just talk, just in closing, a few kind of what-ifs.
Right.
So let's take, you mentioned earlier about hitting the backboard.
Right.
So that means if someone from their shot throws the ball, it doesn't hit anything else, or does it matter?
It does matter. So if you hit another ball, another bocce ball, or you hit the Pollino en route to the bumper, your ball's still live. But if you throw a ball a valid shot, and it goes all the way to the backboard, the bumper, without hitting anything else, it is a dead ball. Likewise, if you throw the Pelino down there and hit the bumper, we'll put it on the dot here. Technically, when you're measuring whether a Pelino shot is valid, it has to be, if I can get on a shot here, the Pelino has to be one bocce ball width away from the side bumpers or from the rear bumper. So rather than having some measuring device, you can just roll a bocce ball past the side bumper and the Pelino, and if it passes freely, it's valid.
Okay.
Even if it's hit it, it can hit the sideboard first and then come to a rest.
And if it doesn't go past the white line?
If it doesn't go past the white line, we simply pick up the Pelino and put it on the white dot, and play continues with the same person who was going to throws again, throws the bocce.
I think that pretty much does it.
Yes. I would say the one thing that people don't really take into account is you can bank shots.
You can
hit the other bocce balls out of the way. So if you are an offensive-minded and a good aiming bocce thrower, you can throw your bocce ball to hit the other bocce ball out of the way or to even make the Pelino track away. It doesn't matter how far away the bocce ball is from the Pelino. If it's the closest, it's the point.
Okay. Hey, listen, thank you very much.
Yes, you're welcome.
I think this hopefully this helped a lot of you who were curious about why we're all laughing and screaming and having a good time here on the, I say bocce, he says bocce. I don't know which is correct.
Well, I used to say bocce too.
Oh, until you learned?
Until some Italian said that means kiss.
Yeah.
So
kiss the ball. That's
right. But he said, don't be saying kiss to me.
Oh, I thought that's the reason they did it. You wanted to kiss the
Pelino. Bocce with two C's sort of means ball.
Oh, okay.
Ball anyway, game.
X knows everything. If you have any questions, I'm going to put his personal phone number down here.
You can
call him 24 hours a day, 7 days
Great.
A week. And he'll answer. No, I'm kidding.
Yes, I know.
You don't have a cell phone, do you?
Yeah.
You can sign up at the front desk, reserve a court, tell them you want to play. They have sets, as we mentioned. You just take them out, sign them out, come and play till your heart's content. And truly, if you have questions, ask somebody at the front desk, and they will direct you to somebody who can help you. Hope you've enjoyed this little... Right. Video.
I would like to add one little thing about, we still are under COVID restrictions, so you really must reserve a court. I know it's tempting to come up with your grandkids and just start playing, but the reason why we have the reservation system is simply in case someone has reserved a court, they then get first rights. We don't want people to feel like they're getting pushed off. You simply make reservations and then the court is yours for that time.
Okay. Bocce on.
All right.
Thanks.